Thank you, Georg. For me, it's also a really emotional moment and a great honor to moderate this panel. But I have to say, the real stars of Soviet architecture field. And in the first panel, we will try to discuss what was the Soviet architecture. Was it just like the outcome of a certain period, or it was like the logical continuation of the project that had started in the very early 20th century, from the very 20s, 30s, it passed through the Stalinist epoch, and starting from the mid-50s, we've been really witnessing absolutely new type of evolution in its quality, in its dialectics. And I would like to invite our first speaker, Vladimir Belogolovsky, to take the floor. And Vladimir Belogolovsky is the founder of the New Yorker-based International Curatorial Project, trained as an architect at Cooper Union in New York. He has published over 200 articles and is the author of the books, including Soviet Modernism, which he did in collaboration with Felix Aronovich Novikov. Please, and Vladimir's talk is going to be the Soviet architecture from generic to iconic. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Ruben. Let me just start the presentation. Can you hear me? This is on. Or this is
on. Switch it off and switch this on.
So.
Ben, Soviet modern architecture can be analyzed on a number of levels, and I want this particular presentation to illustrate Soviet post-war projects from a particular angle by pointing to a certain progression Soviet project being conceived and built as generic, to borrow a medical term, or anonymous and non-discrete projects, to architecture of the iconic, image-driven, signature-type structure projects. And I think such analysis is particularly relevant today because architecture today has been in architecture today a similar shift, but in a very different direction from the iconic to generic, especially from such projects as the Guggenheim in 97 and other projects in early 2000, which were very, very iconic, to in the direction of more generic projects today, generic and performance driven. As we know, the conversion to modernism in the Soviet Union was initiated by Nikita Khrushchev and was achieved very quickly with mainly two goals. One goal was social, to provide every Soviet family with an individual apartment. And the second goal was economic. Buildings had to be standardized and built very quickly, very economically, and with what was labeled at that, without what was labeled at that time as superfluities. Initially, even important cultural projects were built as generic containers, and here is a Soviet pavilion from 1958 in Brussels. Despite long tradition of Soviet pavilions being built as heroic and ideological icons, such as Paris Expos of 1925 by Melnikov and 1937 by Yefan, this building did not feature a distinct form. The building in Brussels did not feature a distinct form. 1958 Expo was the first Expo after World War II, so it was very important. It was held at the height of Cold War, and here you can see American flags in the foreground, which means that American pavilion was facing directly the Soviet pavilion, so it was there was a lot of tension in this particular part of the exhibit, top of the expo, and yet architecture at that point did not carry any signs of ideology. Palace of Pioneers was one of the was a competition winning project, was one of the most innovative projects at the time. The project featured many innovations such as open composition, blurred boundaries between interiors and the landscape, deep cantilevers, new materials, new finishes, very wide structures. Many solutions were carried out right under construction site, and the project became a true testing ground for a group of very young architects. There was a lot of enthusiasm on the part of this group of young, very young architects. Khrushchev personally opened this project, and in his opening speech he said, "Beauty is very subjective. One person may like it, one another person may not like it." And then he paused and he said, "But I like it." And that was very important approval of the head of the state. He approved the direction that modern architecture was taking in the Soviet Union. The form of the project is not iconic, but the project itself became the icon of the 1960s and of the renewal processes in the Soviet Union. And here's a concert hall building which presents itself as a pure, minimalist and refined block of glass. Hotel Yunost, or Youth in Moscow, is another example of a pure suspended over the landscape, refined minimalist volume. In early 1960s, a great deal of new buildings were built as millions and millions of people still were living in communal, dilapidated apartments. The there were many, many projects built at that time. In just 9 years, 54 million people were moved to individual apartments. It was about a quarter of the entire population of the Soviet Union. But in contrast to the refinement of the first projects, first modernist projects, thousands of featureless residential blocks without top and bottom were built all over the country, all over the Soviet Union. And many of these projects ignored very distinct typographic, cultural, geographic conditions. And as noted by Alexander Rybushin in this quote in his book, Landmarks of Soviet Architecture, the character of the whole country was lost. Here is a project by Mikhail Pasokin. He was the head architect, chief architect of Moscow for over 20 years. It's his Kremlin Palace of Congresses. It was built as a blunt, out of scale, out of place, a very nondescript and featureless volume in the midst of historical cathedrals of 14th to 19th century cathedrals. But despite its generic form, the building became an icon of its time, and it remains the only modern structure in Kremlin complex. Here's the Palace of the Arts. Appropriately, it assumes a form of Doric, a section of a Doric column, making it one of the first iconic examples of Soviet modern architecture, and it symbolizes a temple of the arts. Here is a very elegant ball of a stadium, which with its curved and straight ramps within a circular plaza resembles very dynamic paintings by Lisitsky and Malevich. And here's another complex in Expo 67. By mid-1960s, Soviet architecture was producing more and more iconic structures. So you can see the contrast between this particular building and the previous Expo building from 1958. This became one of the most popular projects in Montreal. It was visited by 13 million people, and after the Expo, the building was taken apart and reassembled in Moscow as this heroic icon. The 1960s saw the rise in popularity of futuristic and utopian projects. They were inspired by Soviet victories in early explorations of space. And here's one of the most published student projects by Vyacheslav Loktev here. You can see that it resembles a modular space station, and also is reflected in similar projects by Japanese metabolist here. And the project explores ideas of building residential clusters, massive housing clusters that would grow in size with height of the building to occupy small footprints to free up the land. Here's another building that looks like it's just about to take off. It's TV Tower Stankina. A plethora of global building types was completely missing in the Soviet Union, and it was mainly an opportunity to build, to create very iconic and unique architecture when there was an opportunity to work on this unique building types, and TV Tower was such a type. It was a monolithic concrete structure. It broke many records. It was world's tallest building, over half a kilometer high. When it was built, still remains to be the tallest structure in Europe, and it has many many images, that it recalls many images such as a syringe or rocket, or the base of the building resembles an upside down lily with 10 petals. And with traditional churches, the building appears to be a modern cathedral of technology. Here is Tsiolkovsky State Museum of History of Cosmonautics in Kaluga. It shows their unusual composition with locked-in-place soft form of their off-center parabolic dome of the planetarium, which appropriately recalls the form of a spaceship. And here is Kalinin Prospect, also by Pasokhin. It's a major thoroughfare with 5 residential towers and 4 office buildings. On holiday nights, they illuminated the sign and they spelled out the name of the country, SSSR or USSR. These buildings, they had a common commercial base and everything from overall composition to street furniture and window displays was designed according to a single integrated vision. The complex was criticized by destroying historical fabric of the city, but it became nevertheless a very iconic project, very memorable project, and it symbolized, it showcased modernity on a giant scale. And here's the building which culminates the same prospect, Kalinin Prospect, also by the same architect, Mikhail Pasokhin. This is Sev building, which opens to Moscow River, and its unusually dynamic form is made up of 2 softly bent wings united by elevator hallways. And the form is associated with an open book, and it symbolizes openness for collaboration. Interest in the heart of Moscow. It was a particular version of Sigrum building in Moscow. This architecture did not find much fondness, and the building did not become an icon, as opposed to such buildings in New York as the Sigrum building and River House and Panam building. It was condemned as unworthy, and in early 2000s, the building was demolished. And another project was built in its place. And here's an administrative building in Rapla, Estonia from 71. Despite its modest scale, the building with an almost inverted reflective pool conveys monumentality of stepped pyramids of pre-Columbian civilization. The complex is also It also recalls a fantastic luncheon pad. Many buildings, particularly circuses all over the Soviet Union, were designed to look like flying saucers. And here's a scientific research center in Kyiv and the famous Kazan circus in famous circus in Kazan, Russia. The circus is a giant structure with a lower plate-like structure holding the upper plate. It has 65 meters diameter, and it doesn't have any internal supports. So when the building was built, it raised a lot of questions, and the local government actually asked the architects and engineers of this project to test the buildings in person. So they were placed under the building while 2,500 soldiers filled the auditorium. And obviously, the building withstood this very severe test, and nobody was hurt. Here is Our tiny buildings were built on many different scales, and here is a very small pharmacy in Moscow with Red Cross symbol. This building perfectly falls into the category of ducks, if you use the terminology of Robert Venturi of categorizing buildings into ducks and decorated sheds. And here is Cinema Russia in Yerevan. The profile resembles double peak of mountain Ararat, which is in Turkey, but clearly visible from Yerevan. And Ministry of Highways in Tbilisi by George Chekhova is appropriately associated with multi-level highway intersection. This unusual solution allowed minimizing the building's footprint to retain most of the site untouched. It also resulted in a smaller number of floors, which was a much more economical solution. This photograph I took a couple of months ago when I was in Houston, so obviously Chekhova couldn't see this particular intersection, but you would agree that that was one of the inspirations for this building. But also, the building in Tbilisi explored a popular theme in architecture, which is horizontal skyscraper. And here you see fantastic visions by Lisitsky and Lazar Kidepil, who the projects which obviously inspired George Chekhova, the architect of the ministry. Automotive service center in Moscow by Leonid Pavlov, whose architecture featured grand scale in the spirit of Le Corbusier. The building is triangular in plan, and it is associated with forward-striving aircraft carrier. And here's another project. Here's another project which resembles a ship of it's a sports complex. It resembles a part of a ship without superstructure. And here is airport in Leninakan. Formally, the project is based on very rigorous use of geometry. Its form is a repetition of a quadrant, so you can see it's a repetition of a quadrant three times into this wave-like structure. And it allows a very economical system of construction as it is based on the use of identical mass-produced elements. And here is another iconic project. It's a sports and concerts complex in Yerevan. Its shape is it's built in the shape of a fluid iconic form of lotus flower. And here's another project by Vasilevsky and we will hear his presentation in much more detail. But this unusual structure is more associated with wheel gears of a giant mechanism than a building. If Le Corbusier called his residential buildings machines for living, then this building could be called machine for resting, as it was a sanatorium. And apart from wheel gears, the building is planned as Jeremy Bentham's panopticon, designed for prisons, but it could also be applicable to hospitals, schools, sanatoriums, daycares, and asylums. And I talked to the architect yesterday, and he didn't have any of these images in mind when he designed the building. But I think in retrospect, it's valid to relate in this project to this metaphors of wheel gears and panopticon. Here's the last project I want to show. It's already from 1987. The Nilsky Food Market in Moscow with its flower-like roof, which does not communicate the building's function, but the form serves as a memorable symbol for market. And the last slide. I just want to summarize some of the images of the Soviet buildings and some of the images, some of the metaphors for buildings built in the West, namely after the war. So while many critics declare the end of the iconic building, especially after redesign of World Trade Center, which failed to come up with a meaningful iconic solution, it can be argued that the iconic building is here to stay. And one reason is that to support that is in the fact that there is an increasing concentration of power, money and power, in the hands of multinational corporations and governments. But I think the main reason I believe the iconic buildings are here to stay is because there is a natural desire on the side of the architects to produce this very memorable, very iconic structures and buildings. And at the very end, I just want to plead to practicing architects, please do not give up on the iconic buildings. Thank you.